Good afternoon and welcome. It's lovely to see so many of you on this beautiful day when I imagine some of you wish you were outdoors rather than indoors. But we're delighted that you're with us and we know you will be delighted to be here. I'm Brinton Likes, and it's a pleasure to welcome you here through the Center for Human Rights and International Justice, where Tim Kars and I work with Dan Canstrom, who unfortunately is unable to be here today, but sends warm greetings. Delighted to introduce you to our final luncheon series of the semester. It's a huge pleasure to have Barbara Sostaita with us this afternoon. She received her PhD from the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill just last year. And prior to that, she received a master's in art and religion at Yale University with a focus on migration and religion, and also received a certificate in women's and gender studies from the University of North Carolina. And I just learned that she will begin a tenure track position at the University of Illinois in Chicago. This summer. So many congratulations. She's currently a postdoctoral fellow at the Mahindra Center for the Humanities at Harvard University, where she's has completed editing her manuscript, which is now under consideration at Duke University, entitled Sanctuary Everywhere, Fugitive Care on the Migrant Trail, which focuses on the Sonora, Arizona borderlands, where she documents moments of care and intimacy that expose the impermanence and instability of border militarization. Barbara will speak to us today in a talk entitled Sanctuary on Wheels, Wayward Care in the City of the Deported. Many of you have heard something about the sanctuary efforts in the United States, both historically and more recently. Those that seek to prevent and shelter migrants from deportation processes. This is based on her research in Nogales, Sonora, notoriously known as quote unquote, the city of the deported. And the talk charts sanctuary in the wake of deportation. She travels with Panchito Olachea, a deported nurse who repurposed a church van as an ambulance and treats migrants ineligible for medical care in the border town. She considers how sanctuary travels across and disrupts national borders. So we're delighted to have you here today. Thank you so much for joining us. And you all will have an opportunity to ask questions at the end of the talk. And you online will have an opportunity to do the same.
Thank you so much, Brinton, and thank you, Tim, for making this talk possible. And thank you, everyone, for attending and engaging with my work. I'm really excited for the discussion portion of our lunch today. This is based on the manuscript that Brinton described, Sanctuary Everywhere. This is the third chapter of the manuscript. I'm going to weave in and out of vignettes from the manuscript and overall remarks and comments on deportation and care. So let me begin. When Francisco Olachea, endearingly known as Panchito, left his hometown of Ensenada in Baja California and crossed the US-Mexico border at the age of 16, only a chain link fence separated the twin cities of Nogales, Sonora and Nogales, Arizona. When he was deported from the United States 32 years later, after being arrested and convicted on charges of driving under the influence, the fence had been replaced by the steel bollard wall, now visible from his kitchen sink. The wall has since been reinforced with six rows of razor wire, covering nearly the entire surface. Panchito once told me that he, quote, died on the day he was deported. In fact, homeless, the deportee spent his nights at the local graveyard in Nogales, one of the living among the dead, though at times he wasn't so sure. Quote, I disappeared from Phoenix. My children forgot about me. My house was empty. Is that living? He asked plaintively. Over time, he began to feel the urge to create a new life in the border town. At the age of 48, Panchito enrolled at the local university and earned his nursing license. When I tell him about my religious studies degree, Panchito shares that he was also studying to become a minister, but was forced to quit when those courses conflicted with his nursing school. Panchito credits Christianity with resurrecting him from the dead. Soon after graduating and inspired by his conversion, Panchito began to walk the streets of the border town with a backpack and carrying medical supplies. And he earned the reputation of La Ambulancia Caminante, the walking ambulance. In 2013, Panchito bought a worn out 15-year-old church van to use as an ambulance and named it Panchito y su Cristina after his daughter who lives in the United States. Fittingly, today he lives on Calle Reforma, Reform Road in Nogales. Panchito narrates his life as a rags-to-riches story, a conversion that can inspire others. Deportation was not the end for Panchito, but an invitation to accept redemption. Activists often frame sanctuary as, quote, sacred resistance, as a defense against deportation. Sanctuary, not deportation, is the name of a coalition of faith groups committed to providing refuge to, quote, neighbors who face a deportation order. Given the Trump administration's promise to deport millions and revoke President Obama's prosecutorial discretion guidelines, which provided some relief for migrants without criminal records, the coalition worked to expand sanctuary beyond its typical description, someone going in to live in a church. Sanctuary, not deportation, takes to the streets to defend people and in defense of sanctuary cities and against local detainer policies. They put their bodies on the line to protect people. The coalition hosts Know Your Rights trainings. Its network of congregations provides legal aid, housing assistance, family planning, and bail support funds to undocumented people. Understanding sanctuary not as a place of protection, but rather a set of practices that defend people at risk of deportation. Yet in this manuscript, I argue that framing sanctuary as incompatible with deportation suggests that practices of care are limited to the US side of the border. While affirming efforts to defend people from deportation, I propose that sanctuary does not end at a port of entry. Rather, these practices travel with migrants across borders. Rather than advocating for sanctuary, not deportation, this project studies sanctuary in the wake of deportation. I'm going to use the next 20 minutes or so to offer a very brief historical overview of deportation policy, showing how the criminal migrant, people like Panchito, has been constructed and targeted. Then I'll share a few short vignettes from my work on Panchito through an engagement with Saidia Hartman's Wayward Lives. And I'll propose wayward care as a refusal of humanitarian care, a fugitive movement that spills out of shelters and ambulances. My goal in tracing a very short, far from comprehensive history of deportation is to show how this practice is a racialized one that works to punish and discipline fugitive mobilities. While I start with 1882 with formal deportations, I want to just highlight Adam Goodman's The Deportation Machine, which traces practices of repatriation and forced removal to indigenous dispossession and the fugitive slave laws. So in 1882, you have the Chinese Exclusion Act, which authorized the deportation of Chinese residents who had arrived to the United States after 1880. Adam Goodman points to, in his book, a Daily Tribune article from 1854 that described Chinese migrants as, quote, unassimilable heathens. So we have religion and race working here together. and, quote, lustful and sensual in their dispositions. Every female is a prostitute. So we have the criminalization there already. In 1907, a law made it possible to deport migrants for crimes committed after arrival. So before 1907, you could only be deported if you were an ineligible racial category. But here you have criminal activity being introduced as the reason for deportation. And the 1907 law made it possible, or was created, in fact, to deport people for prostitution-related immigration. In 1917, the Immigration Act created the category of moral turpitude. Moral turpitude is a very vague and capacious category. It includes anything from fraud to robbery, mayhem, prostitution, again, morality and criminality being cast as the reasons for deportation. The 1924 Johnson Reed Act made it possible to deport anyone who violated the law by entering the United States without inspection or overstaying a visa, regardless of how long they lived in the country. So what I want to know as I'm going through this timeline is how the category of criminal just keeps expanding, and the category of who is deportable over time keeps changing. And Naomi Paik is a scholar and historian who does great work showing this. From 1929 to 1939, you have about 500,000 Mexicans and Mexican Americans, US-born Mexican citizens, being deported through what is called voluntary departure, which Adam Goodman cites as the number one way people have been deported throughout US history. Basically, it creates a voluntary departure is tied to violence and fear-fueled campaigns against the Chinese. Operation Wetback begins in 1954. It's an INS, Immigration and Naturalization Services campaign, meant to target Mexican migrants. And I want to point out here how women's deportations were motivated by efforts, again, to regulate morality and social boundaries. Officials, you can see through newspaper documents, archives, distinguishing between good and bad women, and again, siding the bad with prostitution. Just briefly, 1986, with the war on drugs, you get the tying in of targeting criminals and drug offenders with immigration policy. And this completely changes migrant detention and deportation. Congress authorized the deportation of alien felons charged with drug offenses. And a decade later, in 1996, the Illegal Immigration Reform Immigrant Responsibility Act creates the category of aggravated felony, which made it possible to deport permanent residents, people with a green card. The category of aggravated felony includes minor offenses such as shoplifting, becomes a felony, filing a false tax return, and failing to appear in court. This also institutes retroactive deportations, meaning even if you've already served your sentence for this crime, you're eligible for deportation. I just want to end with secure communities in 2008. We can talk about that later if anyone's interested. And felons, not families, which is the President Obama's famous slogan that makes it so that we're not targeting families, we're targeting felons, criminals, not children, gang members, not a mom who's working hard to provide for her kids. And obviously, this language makes it so that you're making it possible to deport people who are seen and racialized as engaging in illicit criminal activity. In Chicago, for instance, the gang database is notoriously misleading, racialized. You could be in the gang database for wearing your pants lower than a certain height. You could be on a gang database and not know you're on a gang database. So these categories create binaries that make it very possible to trace this to Trump's bad hombres language, right? So you're getting a lot of language of criminalization. And Panchito, right, this nurse that I'm studying with who offers care to migrants in Nogales, is a felon, is a bad hombre. And according to immigration policy, he is the type of person who deserves to be removed, whose very presence in the United States is a threat to the maintenance of law and order. And law and order, again, is war on drugs language popularized by Nixon. And so while efforts to protect people from deportation, sanctuary city policies are very much trying to promote sanctuary, they mark people like Panchito as ineligible for deportation. Sanctuary cities notoriously bar anyone with criminal backgrounds from receiving protections, and people like Panchito are ineligible for sanctuary. And so in my project, I'm trying to trace how wayward, unruly, law-breaking migrants, migrants marked as lawbreakers, offer each other fugitive care, refusing the boundaries and limits of the humanitarian care offered by sanctuary cities and sanctuary policies. So I'm going to begin with just some vignettes from my research. While waiting for Panchito at the port of entry, I stopped to speak with a man named Oscar, who unapologetically confesses he lived in Atlanta for 30 years before being deported for his third DUI charge. ¿Por qué te voy a mentir? Why would I lie to you? He shrugs, unrepentant for his behavior. Oscar lost contact with his family after being deported, his children and wife disavowing him después que tiré mi green card a la basura, after I threw my green card in the trash. Deported to Tamaulipas, Oscar immediately boarded a bus to Nogales, thinking he would once again cross the Sonoran Desert. He abandoned that plan immediately after seeing rows of concertina wire lining the 25-foot high fence and realizing how much the border had changed since he crossed in the 80s. After being deported to Nogales, Oscar spent his days sleeping on a bench near the port of entry. That is, until Panchito noticed the elderly man and offered him food and money for insulin. También me llevó a un albergue donde recibí ayuda médica. He also took me to a shelter where I received medical care. When Panchito arrives to meet me 10 minutes later, clumsily parking his ambulance parallel to the border wall, Oscar greets him like an old friend. Panchito slides 500 pesos into the man's pocket. No questions asked. Oscar's need an unspoken assumption. Panchito and I make our way up the Colonia's winding streets into Hogar de Esperanza en Paz, a school turned migrant shelter for women and girls. 9 families live at EPAC, the acronym, including a Venezolana fleeing Maduro's regime, a Cubana lamenting the broken promises of Castro's communism, and a Guatemalteca who escaped her home in the middle of the night without warning and with no goodbyes. La Cubana, traveling alone after leaving her daughters behind with their grandparents, orders the children to sit down before distributing puzzles, math workbooks, and coloring sheets. She is stern, but loving. Meanwhile, mothers gather at the opposite end of the table to create jewelry with another volunteer named Elisa. Today, they're using beads, crosses, and pendant icons to make rosaries and necklaces. La Cubana shows me a green rosary she is making for the woman who saved her life on the journey throughout Guatemala. She doesn't offer me details about the woman's help, but she assures me without her, I would not be here. Since I left my country, women have been my sanctuary. At the shelter, I observe women share responsibility for the well-being of the children and engage in a collective vision of mothering. When a volunteer arrives to take the children to a birthday party, I watch the women clothe and braid their hair and offer advice to all children, regardless of parentage. No le hablen a extranjeros, don't talk to strangers. Cuida a tu hermanita, take care of your sister. No me hagan quedar mal, don't make me look bad. Pórtense bien, behave. At EPAC, mothering is synonymous with sanctuary. During one visit, Panchito and I share lunch with the shelter's manager in the downstairs dining hall, packed with local children sharing a free meal after school. Panchito complains to Juanita, the manager, about a recent visit to La Roca, another shelter, griping that that shelter is an unruly mess. The laundry room is stacked high with piles of dirty clothing and sealed bags of donations that are likely not even being used. Juanita shakes her head disapprovingly, explaining that disorderliness is not tolerated at her shelter. She requires women staying at the shelter to wake up at 8:30 on the dot every morning and immediately make themselves useful, or in other words, profane. We can get into sacred and profane later. EPAC's guests must wash their sheets every week and bathe every other day. Border control, as I argue in my manuscript, is a set of hygienic rituals. They must cook their own meals and share responsibility for daily chores. And yet, time and time again, the women resist Juanita's orders and refuse to maintain a rigid schedule. Juanita laments their indecency. Les digo, ¿qué van a hacer? I tell them, what are they gonna do? Go to the United States to be a public charge for the government? Are they not gonna work? They're gonna confirm all the stereotypes about us. She is disappointed by their lack of self-discipline and worries that their idleness will confirm stereotypes about migrants bent on exploiting welfare systems. I timidly interrupt, asking if she might be confusing their lethargy with depression, and if their lack of energy could be a result of trauma. But Juanita shuts down my suggestions, insisting that simply the women lack discipline. The shelter manager views migrants as disorderly and in need of moral education. As we finish our chicken soup and tortillas, a group of high school students arrive for a late free lunch. No, 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 mothers Juanita, judging the length of one girl's skirt. Así no se puede andar. You can't walk around like that, she decides. She excuses herself from the conversation and walks across the room to reprimand the young woman. Saidia Hartman's Wayward Lives, Beautiful Experiments, Intimate Histories of Social Upheaval, is a portrait of young Black women who fled servitude and debt in the South and sought freedom in Northern cities from the 1890s through the 1920s. Hartman's minor figures believed that, quote, moving on was the only way to make a better life, and flight the precursor to freedom. Their mass migrations out of the South formed a parade of fugitivity. But for their queer sociality and vagrant lifestyles, the women were criminalized as indecent and improper. Quote, immorality and disorder and promiscuity and inversion and pathology were the terms imposed to target and eradicate these practices of intimacy and affiliation. End quote. Often the groups advocating for criminalization of these behaviors were actually progressive reformers and the descendants of abolitionists. To put it differently, in many cases, the very people defending migrants are the ones desperate to transform their waywardness. The 1901 Tenement House Act, for instance, was crafted by official friends of Black people, intent on protecting the poor and eradicating crime and social vice. By 1914, the majority of prostitution charges were executed through the Act's vagrancy laws. Vagrancy clauses targeted those who maintained excessive notions of freedom, who refused the limited option available to migrants. Vagrants were people whose sexual recklessness, errant thoughts, and disorderly gatherings exceeded and defied the law. They refused respectability and dared to chart a path elsewhere. Yet, in my case, at EPAC, women care for each other and share a deep affection regardless of these guidelines, nurturing intimacies out of collective suffering. Their excess emotion and indecent way of living are fugitive maneuvers, disparaged yet deliberate ways of escaping enclosure. One more vignette, a short one. ¿Tienes guantes para mí? Asks a graying man wearing an Abercrombie polo and faded jeans as Panchito distributes business cards to folks and families sleeping on benches near the port of entry. Panchito is anxious to get back to work, but is committed to offering this man the mittens he asked for. So he begrudgingly walks to a convenience store down the street and returns with the gift. Panchito is terse, moves quickly, doesn't like to be sidetracked at the last minute. He hands the man the gloves and walks away. The Panchito who takes me around is leaner than the man who is visible in photos from the early years of his ministry. These days, he wakes up at the crack of dawn to run or swim at the local gym, a training regimen that forms an extension of Panchito's conversion. Wearing a North Face puffer jacket and a stethoscope around his neck, he walks energetically along the port of entry, distributing business cards and offering help to migrants huddled together for warmth. Tom, a retired lawyer who was born in Spain but grew up in Arizona, meets us at 10 a.m., carrying two styrofoam cups of black coffee. One is for Panchito. Tom is outgoing and exuberant. His tone reminds me of a sports broadcaster, animated, accelerated, crisp. The three of us squeeze into the front seat of Panchito's van, me in the middle with my knees pressed against my chest, as the criminal defense attorney, Tom, explains that Panchito invited him to offer legal advice to the asylum seekers at EPAC. When we arrive at the shelter, the children are gathered quietly in front of the television, seemingly bored by Spanish language cartoons, while their moms are curled up on their beds, scrolling on their phones, or staring off into space. Panchito directs the women to gather at the dining tables, announcing that Tom is going to offer them important legal advice. Tom holds 5-minute sessions with individual women, an asylum speed dating of sorts. When Tom asks for their reasons for seeking asylum, some of the women are hesitant to share details about their experience, and they speak in very vague terms. La situación se puso fea, the situation got bad, or no había trabajo en mi pueblo, there was no work in my town. But Tom asks them to be more specific. Assuming the role of an immigration officer, he asks them why they deserve asylum. One mom responds, no sé, I don't know. And he throws his hands up in the air in frustration, urging her to take this exercise seriously. Their disinterest and idleness frustrates Tom's attempts to coach the women through these interviews. He counsels each family on their response to his questions and encourages single women with children to cite gender-based violence in Mexico. It's not lying if it's true, he tells me. Many people are fleeing because of femicide. Panchito paces up and down the halls of the small shelter, eager to make it to his next destination. As Tom urges the women to try to build lives in Nogales, tu vida es ahora, your life is now. No empieza cuando llegues a los Estados Unidos. It's not going to start once you get to the United States, he claims, frustrated with these women's unrealistic expectations to make it to the US. He wants them to focus on the present, to see potential in the here and now, and not wait for salvation in the future. Later, in Panchito's ambulance, Tom complains that none of the women had a game plan. Few knew what asylum meant, almost no one had strategized how to advocate for their asylum case. He is frustrated that the women spend their days idling in the shelter and passively waiting for their numbers to be called by immigration agents. They could be settling down in Nogales, looking for work, building a life for their families. Instead, they spend their days daydreaming about an imaginary life in the US. Quote, maybe next week I can bring a friend of mine to recruit for the maquiladora. Tom explains to Panchito, maquiladoras are factories, low-wage factories in border towns. Hoping to disincentivize the women from crossing, attempting to tame their unrealistic expectations. Tom explains that after a few years working for these maquiladoras, the women could get border crossing cards. He says that's their best chance of ever seeing the country they dream about. Immigration law, Tom observes, is very similar to criminal law. Quote, your client doesn't have a prayer and your job is to deal with the sentence. In the end, although humanitarian agencies differentiate between victim and criminal migrants, Tom's comments suggest that migrants are de facto criminalized, meaning they are, to cite Lisa Marie Gacho, quote, ineligible for personhood, as populations subjected to laws but refuse the legal means to contest those laws, as well as denied both political legitimacy and moral credibility to question them, end quote. And while humanitarian care works to discipline migrants' waywardness, in this instance, by Tom encouraging migrants to settle in Mexico and sell their labor to US-owned maquiladoras, most migrants refuse these recommendations and continue their meandering maneuvers. Indecency and waywardness are creative and intimate attempts to deal with the death-dealing sentencing, or what Lisa Marie Cacho calls, quote, racialized rightlessness. Panchito parks his ambulance next to the rundown basketball court at Grupos Beta. As he and Tom approach the center of the court, a crowd begins to gather. Levante su mano si están buscando asilo. Raise your hand if you're looking for asylum, Tom asks the crowd. Everyone raises their hands. Levanten la mano si han recibido asesoría legal. Raise your hand if you've received legal counsel, he continues. But this time the crowd is still. No one raises their hand. Tom explains to the crowd that there are two requisites for asylum, a credible fear of persecution or torture, and membership in a targeted social group, such as race, religion, or nationality. The lawyer moves to the metal benches next to the court and speaks to migrants one at a time. Noticing a line forming next to his parked ambulance, Panchito walks over to treat people in need. I follow and, according to his requests, take pictures as he greets his patients. Panchito takes an Honduran migrant's blood pressure, telling me that the man suffered a heart attack a few days prior. Tienes muy alta la presión todavía. Your pressure's too high still, he tells the migrant, who is stubbornly not taking his medicine. Tienes que tomar tu medicina. Dios no te va a salvar de todo. Hay que hacer tu parte. You have to take your medicine. God's not going to save you from everything. You have to do your part. Panchito scolds him. Te quiero ver mañana. Aquí a esta misma hora. I want to see you tomorrow in this very spot at this very hour. After he sees his last patient, Panchito and I go for a walk at the cemetery across the street from Grupos Beta. Endless rows of stone altars honor the deceased, decorated with images and statues of Our Lady of Guadalupe and El Niño Jesús. Panchito seems at home among the dead, reminding me that he spent many nights here after being deported. When he overstayed his visit at local shelters, Panchito learned how to unlock, he's pointing here, the individually fenced in gravestones and sleep atop the granite surfaces every night. The dead offered Panchito sanctuary, their graves a shelter and refuge in his darkest nights. People get forgotten when they die, he tells me, soberingly. So do deportees, I respond, aware that migrants are replaced by their employers and their memories often fade from their communities. The US government imposes a 10-year inadmissibility period after deportation as a punishment for transgression. As we pause in front of a gravestone honoring a man who died in a shooting in 2015, Panchito continues, quote, "Every city I visit, I like to go to the graveyards because they're like museums," end quote. Refusing to forget, insisting on honoring those disappeared and removed from sight. He was once one of them too. For Saidia Hartman, Wayward alludes to the attempt to elude by never settling. Or alternatively, an unregulated movement of drifting and wandering. Hartman's Black, queer, and female protagonists have been historically surveilled and criminalized through vagrancy laws, jump raids, and extrajudicial violence. Yet, through excess intimacy, the women Hartman chronicles in her book find ways to escape capture and imagine otherwise. Like Hartman's chorus of characters, migrants' waywardness fosters intimacy and relation. They are policed precisely because of their mobility and disorderliness. Quote, "They stay, but never settle," writes Hartman. While conducting research in Nogales, I met a cast of similarly wayward characters. Besides Panchito, it was rare for me to see the same person twice. This poses a problem for ethnographic research. Most shelters in Sonora permit overnight stays only, one night, meaning that migrants are left to wander the streets during the day, seeking sustenance, chasing entertainment. Deportees are endlessly migrating and meandering. They relocate from one shelter to another, pack their belongings, and try their luck in another border town, Reynosa or Hermosillo, when they tire of waiting for asylum. They sell merchandise at the port of entry, sell their labor outside church courtyards. After being deported, they rest at local graveyards for a few nights before attempting the crossing once again. Maybe this time they will cross the desert with a friend they made at the basketball court adjacent to Grupos Beta. Maybe they will cross with a backpack full of drugs as burros for a cartel. Panchito y su Cristina offers mobile sanctuary to a community that is, often forcibly, on the run. As I show throughout my manuscript, sanctuary movements often seek to rescue the indecent and redeem the wayward. As a recovering alcoholic and committed Christian, Panchito is not exempt from this discourse, and he frequently seeks to reform migrants. Yet, these migrants often undermine and subvert his efforts. And there are moments of ambiguity and tension when Panchito himself refuses narratives of redemption. He lingers in the graveyard, unable to let go of his past. He refuses to ask questions of migrants, giving without limits. He converted to Christianity, but when I visited his home, saw Buddha and Ganesha in his home altar. Waywardness and indecency offer alternative paths to freer futures, even if and when sanctuary workers attempt to redeem and reform errant behaviors. Quote, "They stay, but never settle." And that's the end of my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you so very much. We'll now open the floor for comments, questions. Please introduce yourself.
Yeah, so thank you, Maria. I'll repeat the question for Zoom. Maria is asking broadly about the Barack Obama felons not family rhetoric, his record of deporting more migrants, being the deporter in chief, and how do we reconcile maybe defending migrants with the reality of criminality or criminal behavior? I'll start with an anecdote, with a story. I'm an ethnographer, so storytelling is my favorite way of responding to questions. I grew up undocumented. My family came to the US in 1998 and overstayed our visa. And when I was growing up in high school, there was no DACA, Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals. And I was part in the mid-2000s of Dreamers, who were advocating for the original Dream Act of 2010. At that time, our language was, and we were advocating for ourselves during the Obama administration by saying we did not choose to come here. Our parents brought us here. We were children. We did nothing wrong. Over time, my generation has learned about the limits of that discourse and about claiming to not be criminals, claiming to be deserving, claiming to be high achieving, and what that does in terms of disavowing those who could never, ever meet those qualifications because of race, especially Black and Indigenous migrants who are marked as already criminal, right? If you look at statistics of deportation, Black migrants are overwhelmingly represented in deportation because of police presence in Black communities. They're just more likely to come into contact with the police. And if you saw that timeline I presented, what counts as criminal keeps expanding. So someone marked as criminal now, Panchito, who was deported because he was driving under the influence, before the 1996 Act, he was a green card holder. So before 1996, he would have served his sentence and not been deported. He would have stayed. But criminality keeps expanding. And so my response when people ask me, but what about criminality or criminal behavior? What is criminal behavior? Because that category is so capacious and changing. So I don't like to advocate for migrants by saying we are not criminals or some of us deserve it while the criminals don't, because one day those of us who are good will also be criminals, right? One, like that category is so shifting. And I'll just mark or note that Joe Biden just recently approved more money for ICE than any president before him. So yeah. Policy, I have decided to think about care and intimacy and these underground practices because fighting for policy changes for me just got really, really overwhelming and seemed to be leading to dead ends so often that I'm looking at ways people practice care and subvert militarization in other ways. But thank you for your question, Maria. I think I saw a hand there maybe, no? Those of you on Zoom, the question was, what are other routes or practices of care and intimacy that I explore in my work beyond Panchito's ambulance? I'll just give a brief overview of my manuscript. The first chapter is titled The Desert, and it is focused on indigenous Tohono O'odham water and land defenders who are holding ceremony in defense of the land. And they see border militarization as a denial of sanctuary to the land and more than human inhabitants of the land. And so that traces practices of ceremony and land defense in the Sonora Desert. Chapter 2, The Detained, looks at women incarcerated in migrant prisons and how they are practicing sanctuary while confined in the prison through forbidden or illicit touch. So you're not allowed to touch another incarcerated person in prisons. And so I look at how through prayer, breath, touch, and intimacy, these women are subverting their criminalization. Chapter 3 is The Deported with Panchito. Chapter 4 is The Dead. I look at and work with and am close friends with a Colombian artist who makes crosses and goes to the desert every Tuesday to plant them at the exact coordinates where migrant remains have been found. And so he also holds ceremony and mourns people who the state deems not worthy of mourning. And so I'm looking at these practices of sanctuary that are mobile, that are fugitive, and that cannot be easily traced if we're looking at sanctuary as resistance or organizing. Yes.
Daniel Montanez.
So Daniel's question is about ecclesial communities on the Mexico side and their response to deportations. I will say the Kino Border Initiative, named after Eusebio Kino, Father Kino, is one of the most well-funded and expansive programs for deportees. So at the Kino Initiative, it's a Catholic initiative. There's a shelter that they just created a new building, an expanded shelter and food hall. So there's meals for deportees. There are people, when you get deported, when you get captured, your belongings are confiscated. If you had money on you, you get that in form of a cashier's check. That's only payable in the United States. So if you're deported, what do you do? And so there are volunteers at Kino who will cash the checks, give people their money. You can call family and tell them, I've made it to Nogales, I've been deported. You can get medical care there. There are nurses. And you can sleep there, I think, for a week. I'm not sure about the timeline. But Kino Border Initiative, which is a Catholic organization, is a really great resource for folks. Almost every shelter is run by a church. La Roca is run by a Pentecostal church. EPAC is run by, I know they're Protestant, but I don't know what denomination. So almost every single shelter is run by a church. And I know maybe the Texas-US border, Ciudad Juarez area, there are even more Catholic agencies and nuns who will accompany people, meet them once they're deported. Like immediately you're deported, they greet you and they accompany you. The couple that my second chapter is based on, the detained, they were extorted by US government officials at the airport. They're from Venezuela. They flew to Mexico. As soon as they were in Mexico, they were detained at the airport. And in exchange for money, they were let go. They experienced a lot of extortion and a lot of abuse. And it was a nun who told them, if you want to get asylum in the US, we need to go to the police here in Mexico and we need to report this, accompany them. So I think there are these practices of trying to reform and discipline migrants that I think is very important to track, but the people doing this work with deportees are largely ecclesial communities. Yeah.
I wanted to introduce myself to Dylan. I have a lot of interest in working with the intersection between religion and border identity. And I'm curious, kind of expand on that question too, and you kind of mentioned this briefly in your talk about how the nurse you were working with had within his home, not only icons for Christian or Judeo-Christian religions, Catholic religions, but other religions also. Do you find that clergy that are working within this realm are oftentimes expansive of various types of traditions of faith, or do you feel? Because oftentimes, especially in the Western United States, religions that are oftentimes anti-migrant have a lot of ties within Christian faith communities, and they're almost synonymous to a lot of anti-immigration reform. So I'm curious if you found that the people that are working at these intersections are often expansive of these sort of traditions.
Yeah. Yeah, it's funny. Panchito has Tibetan prayer flags in his altar, conch shells, a lot of objects that and material devotional iconography that spans so many different religions. I asked a friend about this and he was like, oh, that's very Mexican of him. Like the more, the better. Like we, like the more divine protection you can get, like the better off you are. And it was funny, I was in Chicago a few months ago in Pilsen, the Mexican neighborhood in Chicago. And there are like altars in front of homes that look like a museum of every single religious object you could find. And I think it is a very Mexican borderlands tradition of creolization and kind of combination. It's a product of different cultures mixing and merging and coming into contact. I have not worked so much with clergy in Nogales or in the borderlands. Mostly I've worked with volunteers or managers that are hired by churches to manage these shelters. I don't know if I can answer that question very well, but I will say that there is what Claudia Anzaldúa calls a tolerance for ambiguity happening a lot everywhere I went, where ambiguity and contradiction and multiplicity were seen as the norm. Musa is asking about my insistence on care and the need for policy and social and economic justice, or where do those two meet? I said I don't want to think about policy. That was my decision and what I wanted to focus on, because I was so used to the political being seen as policy and organizing, protesting, these very visible, outward, tangible ways that the political manifests itself. And I wanted to see what are the forms of care and intimacy that are also political, but relegated outside the political sphere, that are not seen as political. So that was a personal and methodological decision I made. There are incredible organizers, like the people in Mi Gente, my people with a J, Mi Gente, great law professors, lawyers doing work on deportation. There was a great article in the UCLA Law Review that just came out, The End of Deportation, by Angelica Charasco, I think, who's a legal scholar, outlining like what needs to be done in policy and how immigration advocates are often thinking about reforming deportation, but not about ending it altogether. She's calling for abolition, the abolition of deportation. 100%, I think we need to change policy. I think we need to abolish ICE. ICE is a very recent agency that was created in the wake of 9/11. I think there are so many policy goals that we can work towards. I think that for me and my work, I wanted to trace what is underground and what is unseen, but definitely.
I was gonna ask a question, two things. One is I deeply appreciate this additional angle at trying to subvert criminalization. It has been so clear for so long that this, the good immigrant and the bad immigrant, or the good migrant and the bad migrant, and the so-called low-hanging fruit, which is that experience that you describe in terms of the dreamers, which turns out to have been an absolute disaster for so many people, and a small entry point for others. I'm wondering as you, the notion of the term sanctuary and the provocative ways in which you characterize the disciplinary aspects of sanctuary and humanitarian interventions more broadly. And I'm wondering what you see as the costs of critiquing what is perceived by maybe people in the center who are not pro-immigrant, but also not necessarily wanting to respond to the the horrific violence against migrants, of thinking critically about sanctuary in the midst of the incredible limits on what's available to migrants.
Yeah. So sanctuary comes from the root word sanctus, meaning sacred, and sacer, meaning to consecrate. I play a lot with these root words in my manuscript because I'm very interested in thinking about what is the sacred. And in religious studies, I'm not sure if any of you here are in religious studies, but there was a turn to lived religion in the 90s and 2000s that kind of did away with the words sacred and profane and said the sacred, because the sacred is etymologically what is set apart, what is marked off from the profane. And the profane is the ordinary, the everyday. And they said, well, the lived religion people said the sacred is in the everyday. So how do you divide the two? I come back to those words because I think it's very helpful to think about sanctuary as what is set apart from the everyday, what is marked off from the routine, and what disrupts the ordinary workings of the deportation machine. So how does sanctuary disrupt and interrupt what we take as for granted the everyday? And if the sacred is disruptive of the everyday, and if the sacred is unruly, that's why we keep it separate, because the sacred is disorderly, fugitive. I'm trying to reconsider the sacred and sanctuary as that which disrupts and that which undoes the everyday. I find sanctuary to be a very flexible term. And I think that when we think about sanctuary as disruptive, there's potential there to disrupt kind of these disciplinary workings. I think sanctuary is a last resort. I worked very closely with a woman, Juana Ortega, who lived in sanctuary for 4 years in North Carolina for the entirety of the Trump administration. She lived in a church. She called it family separation. She called sanctuary a prison. She was wearing an ankle bracelet. She was surveilled. There were volunteers who, like jailers, would come watch her 24 hours a day. They were helping, but they were also her guards, her prison guards. I think it's a very complicated tradition, but I think it's one that saved individual migrants, very few people, but it did do something during the Trump administration, and it continues to do something for people living in sanctuary during the Biden administration. So I think similarly to how organizers think that there are short-term and long-term goals and that there are immediate needs and more distant kind of destinations that we're working towards, there are important reforms and there are important ways to make sanctuary more livable and more just in the time being, while there are also long-term reframings that we could be doing. And what I'm trying to do in the manuscript is rethink sanctuary, not as a place, not as one church that holds migrants captive while also protecting them from deportation, but also sanctuary is a more expansive set of practices for caring and sheltering one another.
Thank you very much. We have last question maybe from online, from an interdisciplinary perspective, thinking specifically about the field of social work, are there interventions that can help at the borderlands?
Interventions as in, can I ask the person?
Yeah, try to ask. And actually the attendee does now add, anything people can do to help in a humanitarian sense. So.
Yeah, I think one thing would be pushing the Biden administration. Title 42, which bars people, which is a Stephen Miller COVID limit on entry. Biden said he would kind of withdraw Title 42 and is now considering not doing that yet. And that is keeping people from entering. I know a woman whose son disappeared in the borderlands while he was waiting to get in. When people are stuck in these border towns, they are vulnerable. So I think pushing for Title 42, for Biden to keep his word and redact Title 42. You can donate to organizations. I would say not reinvent the wheel, but support the people doing the work already. So organizations like No More Deaths are doing really great work. Alianza Indígena Sin Fronteras, Indigenous Alliance Without Borders. The OTHAM Anti-Border Collective, OODHAM, OTHAM Anti-Border Collective, is the Tohono O'odham Young People's Movement, Indigenous-led movement. I think, yeah, supporting the work of people who are on the ground and doing this work. One of my friends and colleagues, Dora Rodriguez, runs Salva Vision. She's Salvadorian. She survived the border crossing in the 1980s, and it was her group, 13 of whom survived and 13 of whom died in the desert, that launched the sanctuary movement in the 1980s when people heard that that had happened. She's now a social worker, Dora, for the social workers in the crowd. She's a social worker and runs Salva Vision. They do a lot of work with Salvadorian asylum seekers. She runs a shelter in Sonoita. So she's doing a lot of this work. So I would say No More Deaths, Salva Vision, OTHAM Anti-Border Collective, and Alianza Indígena Sin Fronteras.
Thank you so very much. Thank you all for being
here. Thank you so much.
Many congratulations on the book and your next steps.
Thank you so much.